Welcome to the flute studio of this week, and I think everybody should be in the room at this point, hopefully. Coreisa and Jacob, if you guys want to come up to one of the larger rooms for your choreography, you're welcome. And maybe we should reestablish an order. Emily is already here in the large room, so she could go first potentially. You want to do that, Emily?
Sure, yeah.
Okay, so Emily could potentially go first. And then maybe think about your order. If you do want to come up to the large room, text me and I'll know to organize the room differently and get Emily out on time and all that good stuff. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you to like the most amazingly creative, bombastic, eclectic, gifted flute player, Hilary Abigana. And an incredible entrepreneur whose career I've been able to follow. They used to come to IFS from the very, very beginning, before they were famous and on Broadway or off Broadway. They were coming here for free, right, Hilary? Supporting flute and dance like 10 years ago. And now like everybody knows who they are. And so amazing entrepreneur and business person and artist and inventor and creator and truly an amazing flute player. So I'm going to hand it over to Hilary, who is going to be showing us some of her work, if you're not familiar with it. Then we'll go into the masterclass portion and then we'll have a short Q&A. Okay? Take it away, Hilary.
Hello, my friends. Hello, and thank you so much, Nina, for having me here. Professor Simakopoulos, sorry, Nina. Thank you so much for all coming. And so I am a hybrid arts flutist, which means I combine music, theater, and dance in my performances. And it's usually easier for me to just show you what I do. So what I am going to do is I'm actually going to do just that. I am going to share a little bit of what my trio, The Fourth Wall, does. And let me know if you can't hear this. Just shoot a chat. So that is a piece called The Toy Soldier's Tale. It was originally written for us. It was originally written for trumpet and piano. Then my brother is the composer, Brett Abigana, and he rewrote it for solo flute, and then we had him write an extra percussion part, and then we choreographed it for the three of us. What we do is we try to break the boundary between composer and audience using music, theater, dance, and acrobatics. And we try to create a show in which the audience isn't quite sure always if they're part of it, if they're not, if who is in, it's just all one big mishmash of fun. So that was the start of how we start one of our shows, Fallen from the Toy Box. I end up actually ending that entire show on point as well. Makes for a very physically taxing piece. But I also wanted to share one of the pieces that we presented at the last NFA convention. Let me come back to it here. We created a, we choreographed the Paganini's Caprice, the 24th Caprice, in which it's just me playing, and then the other two members of my ensemble did a lot, the literal heavy lifting of me. And so, and Nina actually filmed this for us and sent this along our way. So this is what happens at the end of an hour-long show. You're exhausted. You still have to do all of the utterly batshit crazy things and pretend like you're not wanting to completely die. Hope you enjoy.
Jump in because I was bringing back so many good memories. That show was so amazing. Like, by this point in the show, everybody was already completely blown away by everybody. And just so this kind of show is just so palpably energetic in the hall because the audience is so keenly aware of the, I think, part of the amount of work, or maybe a little bit more. That goes into it, and it's just so impressive. So it's really great to be part of the audience, and that just brought back all good memories because of everything else that happened at that concert. Amazing.
Well, thank you. Thank you. A lot of what we do as the fourth wall, choreographically wise, is we try not to just add choreography or acrobatics for the sake of that. We try to make, there always needs to be a purpose. So you're going to hear me talk a lot today about why are you doing this? Why are you doing these this choreography? Why? There's going to be a lot of why. And then there's also going to be a lot of you can do more. So be prepared for that. When it comes to adding choreography to your pieces, instrument safety does always come first. I promise you, I've never dropped my instrument. We have a safe word in the fourth wall, and that safe word is flute, 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 which is grab the flute and let the human fall. That has happened on occasion where we have to use a safety word, and then someone goes for the flute, and then sometimes I fall out of a lift or whatever. But the instrument safety does always come first, which the kind folks at Powell Flutes are very grateful for. I am a Powell artist. They saw us ride hoverboards and they went, oh yeah, we should make her an artist. But whatever, it works. It works, guys. Ride a hoverboard around Powell Flutes. They'll make you an artist. but that is a little bit about me. I'll be putting, as this masterclass goes on, I'll make sure to put my email address and my website and all that information in the chat. If you have questions, please ask them. I am mostly normal. I am more than happy to answer any questions. Usually questions start with like, why? I am happy to answer why. It's gonna be because. And usually because I don't want to be in an orchestra. Look at the color of my hair. Anyway, so let's just get started. And if you have questions, we'll answer questions. If you have questions later, you'll email me and I'll answer them later. But shall we just get started and have some fun?
Yeah, so Emily's set up to move and go, and so I guess Hilary, you're gonna play her part of her piece, and
I think Dustin, you're gonna play the video, correct? And then I'll just follow along on my score. This is Reflections, right?
Yes, this great. Is Reflections. I can go ahead and do that.
That'd be great.
Hi, my name is Emily Loh, and I'm a sophomore flute performance minor here at WVU. Today, I will be playing the first piece.
And we are not getting sound.
I could hear it. I don't know if you can hear me, but I was able to hear it.
I can hear you, but I could not hear the video.
Okay, then I think we're just running into the same problem. I don't know. Do you, would you be able to, Hilary, do you have the videos up?
And then if you can't hear it, go ahead and type in. And if it looks
like I will pull them up right now.
If it looks like other people can't hear, then we'll just have, we'll have Emily play live.
Okay.
All right, and everyone will just let me know if you can hear it. Do-do. Optimize for video clip. Away we go. Let me know if you can't hear it.
My name is Emily Loh, and I'm a sophomore flute performance minor here at WVU. Today, I will be playing the first page of Reflections by Maggie.
Hello, I'm Jacob.
Awesome. Such good stuff. Such good stuff. Make sure that I pause the video that's going on in my other screen. Cool. All right. Is Emily on?
Hello. Yes.
Hello. There you are. Okay. I'm going to spotlight you so we can all see you. And I'm just going to... Hello. Fabulous job. Holy... Okay, by the way, guys, I'm a swearer, so you're just gonna haul off to deal with it, you're adults. Holy shit, that was fabulous! Okay, such good work, such attention to detail on that music. There is so much going on. There are so many notes on that page. For those of you who don't see the score, like, yeah, it is daunting. And you're just doing a marvelous job. Really fantastic. So some of the things that I would love to know more about is, first of all, why are you choreographing this? What is the character? What do you want? What are you embodying? What are you in this piece?
So I actually just had a lesson today, kind of working on more, exploring more of the choreography aspect of it. But I think in this piece, I think my goal is to just explore different different textures while also using space, using the floor. Since the piece does have a bunch of different textural things in the music, so just kind of accentuating all of those ideas.
Unmute. There we go. I know how to do technology. Awesome. So we're talking about texture. It sounds like we're talking a little bit about levels. What do you want your audience to get out of this? What do you want your audience to feel when they're experiencing this piece?
I think one big thing is, since this is a piece that is definitely not a traditional flute type piece, so that paired with movements, kind of just showing all the things that a flute can do. But I don't know, I guess just a really just different kind of take on playing the flute and performing.
Okay, so one of the things I'm getting a lot of just wanting to show variety, right? We're hearing variety, and I know you worked on some stuff in your lesson today. Is there any of that you would like to show us before we kind of talk about some things from that I got out of the video?
Go for it, Emily. We have a floor routine that she might want to show you.
Do you want us to just show us just a little bit of what you've worked on
today?
Excellent. Do you want to just show us a little bit of some of the floor stuff that you've worked on? Just like a minute tops, because we just don't have a whole lot of time.
Yeah, I can do that. So kind of the first idea that we explored in my lesson, I think we can see, yeah, was kind of on the first page, since there are so many tone bends and kind of glissandos, also pairing that with kind of a body bend.
Take a step back, come all the way. Yep, keep going.
That kind of idea.
Okay. So no, that's great. I love that. So one of the tricky things about floor stuff is sometimes we get stuck on the floor and we're like so mesmerized that we're on the floor that we stay there. And that's a lot of, it's heavy for the audience. So I'm going to try to switch which camera I use. Cool. So one of the things that I always encourage folks to do when they're doing anything involving the floor. Make sure that my headphones can reach. No, we're just gonna unplug my headphones. It's fine. One of the things that I always encourage folks to do, hold up. There we go. Now we're gonna see me. Cool. Is if you ever come all the way down to the floor, this doesn't have a whole lot of tension or any movement to it. Something that if you've ever seen any videos from Palabolas Dance Theater, you will never see anybody like this on the ground. If they're on the ground, there is something that's adding tension. Either they'll sit like this, which has a lot more movement and active. It's active, or they're sitting like this. And so even though as flutists, we're always like concerned about what's going on with our core, we can't use the core, use your freaking core, you know? So I love the fact that you've got, I'm trying to make sure that I'm in the shot. I love the fact that you have this, you know, and it's curled. I wonder how more extreme you can go. Can you get your heels off the ground? Can you really curl? Can you get into a really contorted position? Because this is still a little safe. It's great. It's in comparison to the vast majority of what we do as flute players, it is on the edge. But I want to push you to be a little bit more, a little bit less safe.
So can you try, but go ahead and back up into your room. Can you try to lift your heels, get a little bit more contorted? Can you still play the instrument as you want to do by getting a little bit less comfortable?
Do it again. Do it again. Do it again, and maybe consider not just keeping this relationship flute, this direction on the body. Play a little bit more with the extremes of where this can go. Cool. How does that feel? Probably feels like utter trash, right?
It definitely is cool, and I definitely do like kind of extremes. I'm not used to it, but I'm excited for that.
Yeah, so one of the things I think if what you want to go for with this piece is showing a little bit more of what the flute can do, then go really far. Thinking choreographically, one of the things that I want to encourage you to stay away from, which we saw a lot of in your video, is too much of this. Because we see this a lot in flute playing, right? Like that's when we finally start moving while we play and we get a motive, we do the bounce and then we do the sashay, right? And so if we're thinking that what we want to show the audience is these extremes, we've got the different textures and different what the flute can do, then I really just think of any time, like film yourself, and any time you kind of go into that mode, go, okay, what can I do differently? What am I going to do instead of that? Does that make sense? So really just push yourself past that idea. And just basically say to yourself, okay, this is what I always do. Like, this is how I move when I play French Baroque music, right? This is how I play with French Baroque. We're not going to do that here. The next thing I want you to consider is that title. Titles and words have so much meaning. And your audience is going to put a meaning on that title. And they're going to want to derive some sort of meaning for that title for what you're doing theatrically. Because not you're moving, but you also need to think theatrically. There's a reason, you know, why is the musical called Hamilton, and yet the first person we hear is Aaron frickin' Burr? Like, you know, there's reasons, right? So think of, you know, and there's multiple reasons why it could be called Reflections. There's reasons that Maggie Payne may consider the reason why it's called Reflections, and there's reasons why you might. So find answers and then choose for yourself how much you want to make that answer obvious to your audience. You can make it really blatantly obvious. You could choreograph a piece where you are surrounded by mirrors. You know, you could do a piece where it's like it's a song from Mulan. I think it's called it might be called Reflection or something like that, you know? So you could do something like that. There's lots of ideas, but it's how much you want to make it obvious to your audience. I'm always in the camp of make it obvious to the audience, partly because as an audience member, I don't like being confused. I'd like to kind of know the story behind things. And it helps, especially with a kind of thorny bit of new music. You know, sometimes you're not always going to, this is something for everybody. When you play new music, you will not always be playing this new music for other classical musicians. Think about those Western European classical music, as opposed to classical music from other countries. Think about those folks who are new to the scene. Think of your aunt, your uncle, your sibling, who is not so much into this music, but you want them to enjoy your performance. You want them to get something out of it. So consider that.
We only have like 30 seconds, a minute left.
Gotcha. Cool. So, this is a fabulous start. I'm so glad that you're thinking about these extremes. Think about all the extreme strings of level things. And I want you also now to also consider extremes of quality of movement. We always sometimes think about everything must be smooth, so my playing is perfect. No, it can absolutely be crazy and jagged, and it will sound like trash for a very long time. Allow yourself to sound like trash, and then you'll find that sweet spot. Cool. Well done, Emily. Such good work. So much good stuff in here. I hope you are very proud of yourself, because this is lovely. Lots of good stuff.
Thank you for all the advice.
Yay! I was affected.
Can she send you her final version? I think it's going to be epic.
Oh, please. Absolutely send me your final version. Absolutely, please. Please and thanks. So who's up next?
Maybe Jacob could go.
Jacob, are you up? Are you good to go up next?
Yes.
And yes, there is an echo. That's because my headphones are not plugged in. Thank you for who pointed that out. Ugh. Sorry about that, friends. I forgot to turn my original sound off while I had my headphones unplugged. Okay, so hopefully that fixed everything. And all right, we are going to play Jacob. So I'm going to come back. I'm going to share that as well. And yours is a little bit longer. Jacob, is there a certain portion that you would prefer us to experience first? If we're looking at doing like a minute.
For me, it's mostly the middle of the video when I'm playing the alteration between the F and the G flat.
Mm-hmm. The swaying situation. I got you. Yeah. That sounds like a great idea. Okay, starts around there-ish. Cool. And away we go. Let me know if you guys can't hear this. Haha, well, I can't hear it, so that's a problem. That's a new one. All right, why can't I hear that? Give me 1 second, friends. Why? I'm gonna reload that. Reasons unknown, now it doesn't want to play. Dustin, do you want to try to share this one? See if you can get it to work on your end?
Yeah, certainly. I can try. I adjusted something in my settings, so.
I am not hearing anything.
You're not hearing anything?
Looks like some other folks are not either.
Yes.
Why, okay. Technology? Why? And that's just silly. Why is this not working?
I do not.
Let's just have Jacob play, I think. Jacob.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Yeah. Easier if you just pick some spots.
Yeah. Jacob, are you in a place where you can play?
Yes.
Let's do it. You will obviously have to turn your camera on because that will make choreography slightly easier.
I have it on another camera that shows the whole room.
Do you see him, Hilary? There are two Jacob LaBarges in the room.
Yeah, that one.
Cool. All right. Well done. All right. So, yeah. So tell me about this piece.
It's a piece by Karl Heinz Stockhausen. It's called
yep.
In Freundschaft.
Mm-hmm.
And it is basically comprised of two lines of the same formula with an interspersed trill. So like a formula is kind of just a line of melody. So there's like the A line and the B line. And basically he's taken like every other section of it and kind of like alternated between the two. And later on in the piece, right after that kind of development of the trill that I just played, you're supposed to basically showcase which part of the formula is being played based on the direction and the height of the performer.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If it's high and it's A, you're over to the right. If it's low and it's B, you're over to the left.
Yeah. Okay, so this is what my trio usually refers to as a ready-made hybrid arts piece. Like, we're already, like, there's choreography already in there. You've already kind of have some things set up. The thing with composers who write choreography is that they're like, yes, I added all this stuff, and they really have added barely anything. So, what we as performers, we have a couple options here. We can go with what's exactly on the page and nothing more, or we can do more and just take those suggestions and then add on to them and go from there. So my question, Jacob, is which are you?
I would like some ideas to branch out into the like more exploratory kind of not on the page section, but as of my preparation of this piece right now, I've been trying to kind of stick to what he's set and try to develop those gestures.
Mm-hmm. Cool. All right. So one of the things that he has He has things that are literally basically just suggestions for like waist up, right? So he talks about swaying back and forth. He has, you know, high, middle, and low. He says to sort of show the line. And then he also says stuff about playing, having this way, and then this way, and this way, right? I don't know why I don't show it with the flute. Like, he has these three different positions. 1, 2, and 3, right? But everything is very waist up. It's like he forgot that many of us flute players can move. And so that's the first thing, is considering that. But before we even go into that, I think we got to talk about this character. So this is another kind of thorny piece. It's a little bit more heady, and it's got it's called In Friendship. Cool. Great. That's clearly friendship.
We're at about 4 minutes.
Gotcha. Thank you. So what, basically we got to figure out what that means to you. Do you care about the friendship thing? That's an answer. Again, think about that. Think about how that relates to your audience. Do you want to make it obvious to them or not? But that might be something to consider. But then we got to think more about things than just the waist up, right? And if we want to stay with just waist up, we can always make that choice, right? It needs to be a certain choice. And then we need to think about everything waist up. So if we're doing a sway, and if we want to keep it just waist up, we want to be rooted to this spot. If you want to stay, if you make that choice, then what I would like to encourage you to do is think about what your face is doing. As flutists, we always think, okay, everything stays calm. You can, however, completely divorce what's happening here from here. This can stay nice and calm and flute embouchure things, but there is so much that can be done with our eyes and with our eyebrows and with our head that does not necessarily affect embouchure. So if you're swaying back and forth, what is that? Are your eyes swaying with you? Are they staring at something on the ceiling and essentially not moving? Like, those are choices to make. But those are choices that your audience will see, especially if you wear a boatload of makeup like I do. And everyone should, because why not? So that's a thing I want you to consider. Levels are going to be your friend in this one, right? Because he talks about showcasing that melody and showing it with the end of the flute. So what I would do is consider, all right, how high can I go? But then how low can I go, right? And don't be afraid to turn your back on the audience. That's a big, like, no-no. We think we're not allowed to ever turn our back. But that can be really poignant, right? And especially if we're talking about something with friendship, and you turn your back, that could be interesting. Something to play with. All right. So with your swaying, let's try something. We don't have a whole lot of time because I talk way too much. What you can do is, if you want to stay rooted to a spot, I would say put your feet together and make it really obvious that, yeah. And then but see how far you can go without falling over. And maybe it's just waist up. Let's see if I can switch my camera again. So if it's just waist up, like, how far can you go with this movement, with keeping your feet rooted? You know, because you can go pretty far, right? And there's a lot to be done here. Now, if you choose to go the opposite direction, if you choose to be a little bit more wider stance, you even have way more. Now, you can go all the way basically off camera to all the way basically off camera, right? So again, it's those extremes. Now, one interesting thing about that I noticed in the piece is that it actually says partway through that moment, it says to diminish the swaying. Right? And you choose to actually speed it up. That's fine with me. I don't care. Stockhausen is dead. So, but that's something to consider. If you are purposely going against what the composer is saying for a choreographic thing, I want there to be a reason for it, and I want it to be really, really obvious. You know, so I want to see again those extremes, and then if you're diminishing it to faster and tighter, how fast and tight can you go?
We're about
Make sense?
Out of time.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Do you have any questions before I move along, Jacob?
No, that was really helpful. This section has been really difficult for me to figure out like what to do.
It's long.
Yeah.
It's long. So basically, play a lot of different options, not just swing. Just see what extremes you can do. And also try it without the flute. Sometimes we get so stuck with this position that we feel stuck here. So try moving without the instrument, and then that might give you some more ideas as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Well done, my friend. This is a tough piece, and it is. You are killing it. It's so fabulous. So fabulous. Alrighty, who's up next? Is it Coreisa or Nathan?
I think they both said they're good, so...
Who wants to go next? And do you want to do this, like, live, or do you want to see if we could make the videos work? I swear, I watched them all, and they all worked on my computer before.
Yeah, Coreisa raised her hand.
Coreisa?
Yes.
Cool. Do you want us to try to play the video, or do you want to try to do it in your area there?
I was actually going to share my screen and play it for you.
Perfect. Yes, let's do that. I love that. Cool. Let's stop there if you don't mind, Coreisa. Just because I want to make sure I don't miss any chances to talk to you. Cool. Oh, yay, syrinx. Oh, who doesn't love some good syrinx? I love it. Okay, such good work here. So tell me about syrinx. Tell me about this. Tell us about, in 30 seconds, who was syrinx?
She is a nymph.
Uh-huh.
It's not a real story, but the story is really sad, but it's also very beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, she's running away from Pan, the god, and who is in love with her, and she runs to other water nymphs to help her, and they basically turn her into the Pan flute in order to get away from him.
Yeah, that's right. Always trust your tribe. Cool. So the question now is how much do you want your performance to be that story, and how much do you want it to be just choreography? Have you thought about that?
I have, not in that way, but I am trying to, through my performance, create like the emotions that come from the story. That makes sense. So
Yes. So tell me about tell me about that. What emotions are we talking about specifically? What kind of things are you trying to impart?
Searching, looking for help. Fear, I guess, is an emotion. I guess sadness.
Okay. So when you're searching for something, right now in your space, how do you search for something? Just how do you you are right now, you are going to look for a pencil. What are you doing?
Wait, I'm sorry, say that one more time.
If you were going to look for a pencil right now, what do you, show me what that looks like if you're
Oh.
searching for something. Okay, no, that was you did exactly what I expected you to do. You used your hands, right? Right. So, and as we search for things, our tendency we tend to look, you know, we're looking for things, right? Now, as flutists, we get it in our head. Pretty early on, from like our very first teachers, they're always like, two hands, always keep two hands. The thing is, though, is that there is so much of this piece that you can do one-handed. There's a lot of searching you can go. F sharp. So consider what you can do with this other hand. There are lots of moments that you can consider looking for somebody, looking for something. My next question is how much do you want this piece to be a virtual experience, and how much do you want it to be a live experience?
So I was going more towards a live experience, and the choreography kind of came out of what I'm hearing musically. So the point was that it's a performance and I'm just playing the piece, but as I'm playing it, I'm doing movements that aren't, I guess, dramatic, but kind of give like an emotion or help me.
Right. So what I want to challenge you to do is to move this piece without the flute in hand. Because one of the thing, again, we tend to get a little stuck in our the flute moves on this plane thing. And there is more we can do, and there is more with emotion. Sometimes as soon as we get the flute in hand, we go into like musician mode, very proper, you know? And then we don't quite get the movement vocabulary as obvious for those emotions that we want to impart. So searching, for example, if we're really searching, we're using our hands, we're looking, we're not just in this level. We're going here, we're looking under things, we're looking
We got about
over
4 minutes
things.
left.
Thank you, perfect. So we're doing a little bit more active with levels and things like that. Also, for wanting a little bit more of that sadness, again, probably doesn't look like this, right? So we want to embody that a little bit more. What does that look like when you are sad? When you see someone look sad in a movie, what is their body doing? Are they big? Are they open? Or is their head up? Are they standing tall? Probably not, So think about how that changes if you do cave in a little bit. I would love to know why you went to the ground.
So I had a chair at first. I was using a chair as kind of like a prop. And instead of going to the ground, I would sit in the chair. And so when I did it for Professor, the next step was think about the chair and how I connected to it and maybe try getting on the ground instead of the chair. So this
Right.
video was like the next step of
Awesome.
trying, yeah.
Yeah. So the next step is not treating the floor like a chair, right? So what happened was you kneeled down and you were so comfortable and it was easy. So one of the things that I talked to Emily about was making it less easy, you know, that kind of thing. If our movement is easy, then it almost, if it's all easy and very simple, sometimes the audience will be like, well, why don't you just stand still? What's the difference? Like, what's the difference that I am getting out of it, an audience member, between walking and kneeling versus just standing still? You know? So I want to encourage you to go a little further. When I watched the end of it, for those of you who don't know, the end of it, she does go back down to the kneeling, and then you kind of leaned over to one side, and I'm watching, and I'm like, come on, come on, lay down, lay down, lay down, lay down. No! And I was like, God, I was just, oh, I was like, lay down.
Okay.
Because you set us up so well that you're gonna lay down, but you can, you know, you can do, you know, where's the right, you can just you can actually you can just do full layout right across the ground and get this big R movement to be like little afternoon of a fawn situation or something, fawn's going back to sleep or something. But again, extremes. And I want you to consider, you know, once you've done this and you've done this once, you get once, and then you got to do something different. So if searching, figure out different ways to search, if you're looking for something to search, and if you're running from pan, if you're have that feeling of frightened, run. Actually run. You can absolutely run with the flute. You will sound like absolute garbage for the first dozen times that you run while playing. You will be fine. Let yourself sound like garbage. It's fine. It'll get better, you know? So again, just more extremes. This is such a good start, and I am so I'm hearing such great, lovely ideas, and I just want you to go, like, don't be afraid to go further. But try things without the instrument, because I think you might be a little stuck with this and how this must be at all times. But you've got so much more that you can do and so much more you can play with. And I've definitely passed the 4 minutes, so I need to stop.
Yeah,
Thank you
we're
so much.
late, but thank you. Great job.
Excellent work, Carissa. All right.
So last we have Nathan.
It's me. Hello.
Hello.
I have to apologize. I'm stuffed in my apartment and
That's all
tiny
good.
small in my room, so this is about all the space I have.
That's great. That's great. Do you want to do it a little bit live for us then?
Sure. Do you want to hear a specific section or just?
I want to. There was the spot about. It was partway through. No, it's the middle of because you played just. No, you played the whole thing, didn't you? Yeah. Let me pull that music up. I want to start where the beatboxing starts. Let's just do that, a little bit of that goodness.
So
Because
the first time the beatboxing begins.
yeah, unless there's a certain spot that you
That's
would
fine.
prefer to play.
That works.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, let's go ahead and stop there. Oh, so good. Oh, man. Everyone in the studio is so good. Oh, you guys are so great. Holy shit. Makes me so happy. Awesome work. Okay. Whew, this is such a killer piece. I love it. What is a tambin?
So it's a type of traditional flute from Africa.
Specifically where I'm in Africa.
I think it's Northern Africa?
West Africa.
West Africa, okay.
Yeah, so the reason why I bring that up is style of music, West Africa, very different from Northern Africa, very different from South Africa, and of course from East Africa. West African music is, a lot of that music is where we got jazz, y'all, and therefore that's where we got hip-hop, right? So that's where it all came from. So the question is for you, my friend, what character, what feeling are you wanting to impart? What do you want your audience to get out of it? Same questions I've asked everybody else.
Right. I mean, for one, I want to accentuate all of the extended techniques and the use of the flute in a way that's different than usual. And then also hopefully impart a little bit of the culture that the music is supposed to be representing.
Yeah, cool, great. That brings me to my next question. How much West African dance have you researched?
Not enough.
Ta-da! Yes, okay, great. No, that's fine, totally fine. I wanna encourage you to start doing that a little bit more in depth. Look at a whole lot of different videos, get inspiration. I'm not saying that I want you to necessarily emulate that, because there's a line to walk between not wanting to mimic something in a derogatory way, but instead wanting to honor it. So I want you to consider some of that movement vocabulary and consider how that could be brought in. That brings me to my next question, is how much hip-hop movement vocabulary, b-boy stuff, have you looked into breakdancing?
Not very much.
All right. So my guess is that WVU actually has there's a dance program at WVU, right?
Yeah, we have a hip hop club too. They rock.
Hip hop club.
Yeah. No.
Okay.
We've got lots of good opportunities.
Yeah. Okay. So I bet there is a class that you can take in breakdancing. It's first of all, everyone at some point while you are in school, please take a dance class of some sort, any form of dance class. Get to know your body much better. Get to know it. Take yoga, take a dance class though. Any form that you can get your hands on, get your body in, is going to be extremely useful to you at some point. We musicians tend to get very like, this is what I do, and that's it. And we forget that so much of what we do is our entire body. Dancers are so much better at it. They forget that they have a face, and I'm going to make fun of them for that forever. But, and that's when actors come in handy. But what I would love for you to do is start researching a little bit of like some hip hop vocabulary and some of that kind of stuff. Because what we get is great to start off with, and then you kind of hang out there, right? It needs to develop a little bit more, and we need to go a little bit further. And what I would love to see, Jacob just said, we also have African music and dance through the world music department. Fuck yeah, get yourself in an African dance class. Absolutely. Great suggestion, Jacob. That is solid. Because what I want you to do is start thinking about how these movements develop as the music develops. Because once you've done, as I mentioned to Carissa, once you've done something twice, it's got to go somewhere, right? Just like music develops and something else happens, I want you to do that. Now, what you could do is do every time you have the da 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 da, you can go back to that kind of vocabulary, but then as you do other stuff, do something else, right?
Okay. We have about a couple minutes left, and then we can go on to the Q&A.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Dustin. The other thing I want you to consider is, I'm going to switch my camera again. Cool. What I want you to consider is not just, like, you know, da-da-da-da.
We have this movement vocabulary, right? A lot of what happens in hip hop is, again, a little bit more down, a little bit more grungy, right? So I want you to get, like, go ahead and cave in, and I want you to just get a little bit like, you know? And don't be afraid to get your feet off the ground, because, again, I think we got a little, this partly is because you're in your apartment, you don't have a whole lot of space. And that's why it's tough to be a dance and flute player if you don't have a whole lot of space. But you can do it, my friend. I believe in you. Get your feet moving. And what does that look like? Are you doing, like, anything with your feet? Are they moving, you know? But there's a lot of stuff you can do. What I want you to consider is, again, how do you move without the flute? How does that movement vocabulary change if your flute is not a part of it, but you're dancing to it? Just, and what you can do, everyone do this, as you are working on music, have the music playing, get a camera set up, and then forget that the camera is recording you, and just dance. Just whatever comes into your head, just move to it, just move, you know? And if that, and if it looks dorky, who cares? You know, we all sounded like shit the first time we played flute, right? So just allow yourself to look dorky, but keep finding what feels good in your body and what vocabulary you want to bring to this piece. I really love the fact that you turned around a couple of times in this bit, because I mentioned this earlier, sometimes we're so afraid to turn our back to the audience, but it can be really effective. Now, how that turn, though, it was, you had this great, like, grounded, like, kind of thing going on, and then we had this turn that I am, like, 90% certain was a beautiful, like, on-the-toes situation, right? Maybe a different world than what we want. So what does that turn look like if it's still in the same, like, grounded, grungy kind of thing, right? So something to play with, something to film yourself doing, something to research while looking up some more West African dance, some more hip hop. What does that look like? What do you think? Got some stuff to work on there?
Absolutely.
Some ideas? Cool. Excellent work, everyone. You're all so good. And I'm so glad. Like, one of my favorite things about this studio is that your professor is basically like, everybody's gonna move at some point, and it brings me such joy. And I hope that you all continue working on that freedom of movement. There was this big talk on the flute listserv. Nina, I think you're on the listserv, right? I don't know. It's like this big, like, it's called the flute list. It's, I don't know who runs it. It doesn't matter. But they all, like, people will send questions to the whole community, and people, or, you know, or comments, and there's discussions and things. And there was a discussion a little while ago about like moving while playing. And there is a whole community that's just like, never move. And I'm just sort of like, nope.
I posted something last week on Facebook with from Ethan's lesson.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a great question came up, like, well, what, how do you respond to the people who say that movement affects tone, and, you know, or what do you do with that? And my answer was basically, first of all, you have to body map yourself, because if you have all of this stable, you can certainly even walk while you move, and there's no difference in sound, or maybe there is at first, but then you develop the muscles or the understanding of what you're supposed to do to then keep the tone steady, you know, like.
Absolutely.
But I think the issue is body mapping. I think also we are really detached. I remember even college, when I was in college, going to see some jazzers and their concerts, and they were like having way more fun on stage than I felt like any of us were.
You know? Yeah, absolutely.
Lost connection with the fact that the music should move us, and if you have movement patterns that need to be broken because they get in the way of your technique, break them, but then get right back into choreographing movement, you know, in a way that supports technique. So.
Without a doubt. And one of the things that I think our genre
of music sometimes we forget is that we are performers, and we are here, we exist, and what we do as performers is we entertain. You know, I personally feel like there's too often when we do a recital, we're doing it for ourselves, and we're like, I am doing this for me. We forget that, yeah, but they're the ones who are paying the tickets. The audience are the ones who are paying to see this performance. You're there. You as the performer are entertaining them. And we forget that we need to do stuff in service to the audience. And a lot of that is like, well, how am I going to make this entertaining? And for me, there are times, there are dozens and dozens of times where I'm playing something that involves movement and I don't sound good. I don't. And I work on that. I always work on trying to sound better. But then I balance that with, you know, does the overall product, does what the audience experience, is that better than when I am standing still? The vast majority of the time, yes, it is better when I am moving. If it's better when I'm standing still, then I reevaluate. And then I go back to maybe I should do this one while standing still. But if I have elevated that experience for the audience, then who cares if I crack? Who cares if I play a note a couple notes out of tune? You heard the Paganini. I whiffed a ton of notes. But you know what? That audience was damn impressed and they had a great time. And sometimes that's all that matters. There's a whole bunch of questions in the chat. So let's go. How important is the outfit costume in the performance? It is. It absolutely is. And you should absolutely consider it. When you walk on stage, that is your audience's first impression of you. I am wearing jeans today and I look very professional from the waist up. I did that on purpose, partly because I wanted to move in my pants. Second of all, because I did not want to wear dress pants and they don't fit because COVID. So, I mean, what you wear is important and how you make that first impression is important. My virtual recital that I do, my solo recital I did last fall for the Oklahoma Flute Society, I had a different outfit for each piece because I am super extra and I earned that right. Also because it fit what I was doing and I made sure that it wasn't like a big deal. Like sometimes, you know, you'd see me put on the clown wig and it was a thing, but sometimes it wasn't. Considering every aspect of your performance, what the stage looks like, what your lighting is, what you're wearing is important. Musicians sometimes think, oh, we're just here to, people are just coming to listen to us. No, people go to see your performance as well. So how you present yourself is important. And you can just make choices is what I encourage you to do. Make strong choices. Even if it's a weird choice, like torn jeans and a baseball hat, if you're playing Bach and that's what you choose to wear, make sure there's a good reason. And make sure you convince the audience of it. You can do pretty much whatever you want. What does the timeline in crafting choreography generally look like for you? That is a great question, Juan. So when I am choreographing a piece, typically my ensemble, what we do first is, the very first thing we do is we choose the music. We make the arrangement because there's not a whole lot of music for flute, bass, trombone, and percussion. So we will arrange it, we memorize it, and then we put it on its feet. And it is a very long timeline. That being said, there are some pieces, like our version of Satie's Gymnopédie No. 1. In that piece, I'm actually upside down for the entire second half of it, suspended from my trombonist's hands, who are behind him. That actually, the choreography for that piece came first. We came up with the lift, we figured out how to safely get in and out of it. We came up with all that first, and then we chose the music. And then some pieces for us took one day to figure out. Some of it took months and months and months. It sort of depends on the piece. So it definitely varies. How would you teach a flute movement lesson to a student that doesn't have dance experience? Make them do it. Like, dance experience, you need zero dance experience to move while playing the instrument. You need zero dance experience to dance. Like, dancing is something that we can all do. Even those of us who are differently abled, we can dance with different parts of our bodies. We can all dance. And I think just like every person, like all of us can sing, we need to let go of the fact that there are dancers in the world and I'm not one of them. No, fuck it. You're a dancer. We can all dance. So you do it. And you make them feel comfortable with looking dumb. And usually when I'm doing that with a student, first thing I do is I look dumb first. And I make it a safe space to look dumb, to look awkward, to make weird movement choices. If you as the teacher kind of do that first, then it's a little bit more safe for them to play. But just encouraging to go further, do more, look more awkward. It's fine, you know? Oh, great question.
On that one, Hilary, too, because I think the word dance is the problem, right?
Yeah, that is so the problem.
Choreography is a trigger
mm-hmm.
for most people. So the word movement is softer because we all move.
Mm-hmm.
And I really love, as a point of entry, just using adjectives. So how would you now walk across the room looking sticky? How would you walk across the room looking itchy? How would you, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I also think it is key for the teacher always to create a safe space for those moments that require so much courage. And one of them for a lot of people is singing. I encounter this all the time in teaching, not just our level, because you guys are all used to singing in you know, ear training classes and stuff. But like, you know, people are not comfortable singing. So if you ask them to sing something, they don't. So if you just belt it out there and crack notes and just be like, you know, it makes it better for the next person to come in and try to like sing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, being, you know, willing to fly your freak flag and even on purpose. And if you're not comfortable, then developing your own comfort as a teacher so that you cannot withhold that from your students, because you may have a student more gifted with a higher level of aptitude and a burning desire to move and create a multifaceted performance. You personally may not be that person, but you don't want to thwart that or be in the way. You want to be opening windows. So that's one of the great things about teaching too. It helps you develop your own shadow side.
Yeah. So, yeah. All of that.
Yeah.
That was great. Amen. Where do you draw the line between movement for a classical recital versus contemporary performance? There's no line. I have no lines. I have no boundaries. That should be very obvious by this point. Boundaries are an issue for me. I don't see a reason why anyone should feel inhibited to stay in one place if ever. I mean, a lot of those great pieces of classical literature are written by old dead white men, so do whatever the hell you want with them, you know? Like, you can make the choice to choreograph Bach if you want. I have the words are hard. The Marin Marais' La Folia d'Espagne. I do a version of that dancing a Baroque sarabande, doing the actual dance to it. If anything, it helped me play the music better, because I was like, oh, these are the steps for this definite, it's a dance. And now I know how to play it better, because this is the dance, you know. Classical recital versus contemporary performance, it's, if you want to add movement, you should add movement, and you shouldn't feel inhibited by repertoire. I think what a choice that needs to be made, if you have a piece with accompaniment or with another partner, a chamber music partner, say you're playing the Hindemith Sonata and you have a pianist with you and you want to choreograph it, you need to consider the pianist. You need to consider their comfort level, but then also, what are they? What are they doing in this space? What are they a part of? What are they doing as a part of this movement spectacular that you're creating? Are you just ignoring them completely? Okay, that is a choice, but then you also need to consider what the audience sees, you know? Are they just like, wow, that pianist is just like sitting there playing, you know? So it's there's just choices to be made, but I don't see a reason to draw a line
Yeah,
between those options.
I also think, like, my little own favorite quote of myself is versatility is like the new virtuosity. And I think that we need to live by that. And to be really extra successful musicians and entrepreneurs as musicians. So, and influencers and, stuff happening, whatever's being put out there in terms of art that we create that's digital and can be viewed experienced online and stuff like that. So I think just like we don't, at least here at WVU, create classical recitals where everything is within one time period, we mix. I also think mixing our performance is really important. So keeping in mind the entire contour of the whole concert and all the different aspects of virtuosity you're going to show. Like hearing Paganini with movement is like so mind blowing. It was just so amazing, Hilary. I've seen a lot of what you guys have done, and it's all mind blowing. And done with beautiful flute technique too. So wow, if you could
Well,
actually
thank you.
earrings or something that is manageable to do certain movement to, and have perfect intonation and have beautiful this and that. Like, how much more virtuosic can something be? And then if you can stand there or sit there with a trio and play as if you were classically trained and are musician with all the right cueing and understanding body in terms of cueing and all the vocabulary that exists there, that's even more amazing. So I think a performance that shows a spectrum and it doesn't really like cut things up, like Hillary was saying, is really important. So mix it all in and it doesn't matter what you're moving to.
Yeah, absolutely. Last question that I see here is how would you approach working on deconstructing non-healthy movement? First thing I would do is get out of the movement space that is making that happen. So first thing I would do is if I'm working on a thing and I'm doing that, first thing I'm going to do is lay down. Lay down on the ground because it's really hard to lay down on the ground and bounce like that along the ground. You're just not going to be able to do it. I would do that. Next thing I would do is I'd sit on this couch. I'd put my feet up here and I'd hang my whole body off the front of it. I'd hang upside down. But I would play that way and then I would consider the line like as dancers when they talk a lot about, always creating movement. There's very little, especially in ballet, they don't just put an arm out, right? There's always a little bit of always reaching. So how you can use to find like the line of a certain piece, you could move that way. So keeping that line and keep just moving with the line as opposed to say the beat. Those are, I think, for me, the first steps. And then just continuing to film yourself, know what your body is doing so you can go, okay, is that a choice? Do I want to do that in this movement? You can. There's plenty of times I bounce, There's a lot of times I'm. I do that. I bounce all the time. And no one can tell me difference, but that's also a choice. So always just keep in mind if you're moving, make it a choice and not something that just happens.
Yeah,
Yeah.
I love that. I think that's really important. So deconstructing it so that you can actually reconstruct it, and that the key is the reconstruction part. I think people deconstruct and they stop moving.
Yeah.
Then they're in a box and they're afraid to ever move again. So that's it's about building the vocabulary back up and doing it so that you have your body mapped and you know what needs to stay stable and what can be moved. But yeah, that's so key.
Absolutely.
Hanging upside down, lying on the floor, all of that stuff. Sometimes it's fun to actually practice lying down on a couch because it's so wrong. It's just going to break the the laws, you know?
To be very honest with everyone, I've done more practicing laying down on my couch during pandemic, because there were a lot of days that I did not want to get the flute out of the case, because it was just kind of just a mentally, emotionally taxing thing that I was just not in the mind space for. And so I was like, well, I can do long tones laying down. Cause I didn't want to raise my arms. It's too heavy. It's too heavy. And you know, sometimes that happens. And you know what? I was a success that day. Cause I played long tones. I was laying on the ground, but I got the flute out of the case and I played some long tones on the ground. And I think for me, that was a success. And I actually got something out of it. Cause I could just concentrate on breathing. I can concentrate on just blowing air through the instrument, you know? And I think there's a lot to be said about playing in weird positions and not feeling like this is the only way to approach the instrument. I find that the more I play like this, the more tension creeps into my body and I just gotta move. And the more I can move, the better my body feels anyways. But I'm also a twitchy human, so there's that.
Hilary, can you send an email to Dustin with all the links, or even included here, and maybe Dustin, you can put it out in the weekly updates. But everybody, if you get a chance to relax and just kind of have some downtime, check out Hilary's links.
Yeah.
There's so many. Is Masks on YouTube somewhere? Your Masks?
Probably. It's not the most updated version of Masks, but it is on there. I know that... our version of the entire version of Toy Soldier is on YouTube. So youtube.com/fourth wall ensemble. That's my trio's YouTube page. My YouTube page is youtube.com/Hilary Abigana. There's only one of me. I am easily Googleable if you spell my name correctly. Hilaryabigana.com. fourthwallensemble.com. That's like all of our stuff. We have a lot of videos on our website as well as on our YouTube page, and I've got things on my website as well. I included my email address in the chat there. If any of you have questions about this work, if you want to run anything by me, I am more than willing to, you know, take a look. Just let me know.
Yeah. I'll encourage everybody to send you their final version of their.
Yes. Please do. Please do.
Hilary, it was really inspiring, and I hope that you all feel like, yeah, there are many other, well, not many, but there are some other people in the world who are moving with the flute. And I honestly think 50 years from now, like, we're probably not going to be the only two or three people on the planet moving with the flute.
Yeah, right? There aren't that many of us, but we are a small and mighty group.
Thank you. Bye. Thanks, Hilary.
Thank you so much, friends. Have a good one.
Bye.